So, today we are going to cover the advanced methodologies. We have already covered the primitive methodologies in our last session, the waterfall methodologies, the incremental methodology, and the iterative methodology. So, today we are going to cover the advanced methods, that is, Agile Scrum Framework, the Extreme Programming Framework and DevOps Framework. So these are the three methodologies which are extensively used in industry practice these days. So we'll first start with Agile Scrum Framework. Now, the moment I say Agile, so the people around the industry, they perceive Scrum is only Agile, which is absolutely wrong. Scrum is one of the framework under Agile. So Extreme Programming, DevOps, your Kanban or your Safe Agile, Less Agile, these all are part of your overall Agile framework. So Scrum is one of the framework which is extensively used in industry. Now, how do we decide which framework to adopt when it comes to a particular project? So that answer is given by the nature of the project. For example, if we have a project which is operational in nature, which do not have any such development effort needed, for those kind of projects, we would be using Extreme Programming Framework. For projects which are more operational in nature and there is no business involvement, sorry, there is no mediator involved in between, like a business analyst or any typical project manager or any such senior level resources. In that context, we would be using DevOps framework. And Scrum framework is something that we have to use when typically the project size is small to medium, and it has to be development in nature. It cannot be used for a project which is of maintenance in nature or which is of operational in nature. To explore more about Agile, we'll first start with Agile Scrum Framework. Do anyone have any idea, read anything about Agile?
I know a little bit, like it works in little assignments, like little scrums, that at a particular date we have to deliver some deliverables and some part of code, and then it would be tested, and that's how the process goes, like in little scrums, in little cycles.
Okay. So remember in our last session, yeah, someone was saying something. Okay. So rather I would say a working system than prototype.
This is Shubham. So yeah, I just wanted to add, so basically we use agile model when requirements are not well known, and we know that there would be some situations in the project where the requirements may change during the course of a project. I guess most of the Scrum Master or project managers use agile model because initially they don't know what would be the requirements, and the requirements may change after certain time during the project. So yes, that's why agile model.
Yes, absolutely. So one of the key consideration when to use Agile is, like in my last session, I explained you about waterfall model, wherein the requirements were completely clear and were well documented and comprehensive enough for the development team to go on and start their coding. In incremental, we saw there were some sort of disagreement in terms of clarity around the requirements, but yes, the requirements were again very pretty much clear. In iterative model also, we saw the requirements were somewhat clear. But Agile is a model wherein we see the requirements are not that much clear when compared to the primitive models. Why it is not that much clear, there are certain reasons around it. Because the first thing is like, if you start working in an agile context, you have to do away with the comprehensive documentation. For example, in waterfall model, we have a BRD, business requirement document, which is around 300 to 400 pages document, wherein you detail out each and everything, which typically takes 3 months of time. But in Agile, since it's a parallel requirement gathering along with the development, you do not have that much time. So what do you do instead? You write user stories in Agile. You need not to write a comprehensive document, which was a case in terms of primitive methodologies like waterfall. You do not write any comprehensive documentation. For that reason, there may be a case at initially you would be having a predefined set of requirements, which would be pretty much clear. But at a later point of time, when you start exploring the other modules, or in that case, I would say the epics or the features, the requirements are not known at that point of time. So that is the reason why we continuously collaborate with the business, with the client, with the customer, in order to groom our user stories, our epics, so that we get a clear understanding of what the requirement is. Only then we pass on the requirement to the development team for further development. So here your requirement analysis and your development, they go on parallelly, as in, if it's 100 set of features, so first 25 set of features would be analyzed first, then it would be sent out to the development team for development. Meanwhile, they are developing, the business analyst would start working on the next 25 set of features. So this way, the parallel development, the parallel analysis, and the parallel testing goes on in an agile development. Now, agile is predominantly used in product-based organization, wherein we tend to explore the product in a greater extent. If it's a service-based organization, we do not use agile that much. But for a product-based organization, we use extensively Agile. Because if you consider a product, the requirements are evolving at any point of time. If you have implemented one particular feature today, after 6 months, you would be having an enhancement to the same feature. In that way, the product keeps on evolving year after year. I gave you an example of Microsoft Office Suite. It's a product-based development. So it's very obvious that we would be using Agile methodology in that context, because the product keeps on evolving. If that would have been a service-based project, wherein the requirements are known right at the time the project starts, we would not use Agile in that context. So before beginning with Agile Scrum, we would first focus on the four core elements of Agile Manifesto. So Agile Manifesto is something prescribed by the governing body of Agile, who emphasize on four key aspects when compared it with the primitive models. Primitive model means your waterfall model, or your iterative or incremental model. So Agile is a combination of iterative and incremental model. So we have four values when it comes to Agile Manifesto. So the first statement says customer collaboration over contract negotiation. So remember, when we were discussing the primitive methodologies, I said there are many many terms and condition within a contract, that if you do not deliver a project on time, then you would be penalized. If you deliver a project ahead of time, you would be rewarded. There were many such contract in many such terms and condition in that contract. But Agile says customer collaboration rather than contract negotiation. Now the other aspects of contract negotiation could be, let's say in waterfall model, if a customer want to request a change, it was only possible after the project has been completed and the project moves to the maintenance phase. That is essentially after 1 year. But in case of Agile, it's not like that. While the sprint is essentially a cycle of development, which is referred to as sprint. So while the sprint is going on, a customer can request for a change, or customer can request a modification. So in that context, we continuously collaborate with the customer. So that it says the first pointer, that customer collaboration over contract negotiation. We always welcome change in an agile environment. We never say that, okay, as per your contract, you cannot request a change at this point of time in a particular system. If you want to request a change, then you have to wait for this much period of time. We don't say like that. We always welcome change. So that's, it says customer collaboration. Next, it talks about individual interaction over processes and tools. So like we saw in waterfall model, there was no backtracing. Backtracing as in once analysis phase is completed, you have to move with development phase. You cannot go from development phase to analysis phase. But in this case, it is not like that. While the piece of functionality is being developed, and if the developer feels that the requirements are not complete, then developer can reassign that requirement to a business analyst and say that this requirement is not complete, we cannot develop it. So it's business analyst responsibility to get the needed clarification from the business representative or the clients or customer. So forward tracing and back tracing is allowed in Agile, unlike waterfall model. And secondly, individual interaction also says we encourage more face-to-face communication. More face-to-face communication as in we conduct daily scrum meeting or a daily stand-up meeting, essentially a 15 minutes meeting in which we discuss the challenges, the roadblocks, and what all things we would be doing in today, what we did yesterday, and what is proposed for tomorrow. We discuss everything. So most of the interaction are face-to-face rather than interacting with the help of a process or a particular tool. Tool as in any kind of tool, any project management tool. Essentially what happened in earlier years was like, I would take an example of a typical sign-off process, the approval process. In waterfall model, let's say a business analyst wrote a requirement and he sent it for approval. So he has to follow a particular protocol that, okay, I sent a email to the business sponsor today, so let me wait for 7 days. After 7 days, he didn't responded, the business stakeholder. He said that let me send a reminder email and wait for another 3 days. After 3 days, he again didn't responded, and at a later point of time, it was liable for an escalation. So Agile says if someone is not responding you directly, you can directly interact with them, bypassing the processes and tools which are in place, 7 days, 3 days, or an XYZ, until the time it reaches for an escalation. So you need not to wait for an escalation. You can directly interact with that particular person, maybe a face-to-face conversation, maybe a video call, or maybe you could talk over, you know, any XYZ communication channel that you have agreed upon. You could do a more individual interaction. Third pointer talks about responding to change over following a plan. Now earlier, like I said, in waterfall model, we had different phases and backtracing was not allowed. Only after the project has completed and it has reached to maintenance phase, then only a change to a particular particular feature or addition to a particular feature was allowed. But in Agile, it is not that way. You could respond to change at any point of time the customer or the business user asks you to respond. So that's the third point. Fourth, it talks about working software over full documentation. Now, full documentation in waterfall, we saw that the documentation was very exhaustive, very lengthy, and typically ranged from 300 to 400 pages. But in Agile, we emphasize more on working software, the demoable system. We build the system bits by bits, but the entire system is in a working condition. It has certain functionality so that we can test it rather than reading out the documentation for the entire period of 1 year. And at a later point of time, what we have perceived and what we are getting, there's a huge difference in our perception and what is delivered. In order to avoid these circumstances, we emphasize more on working software rather than comprehensive documentation. So that's the four pointer. So basis on these four pointers, your agile manifesto is what I would say compiled. Basis on this four principle only, the entire agile or the agile sub framework work in a typical IT project. Any questions, anyone so far?
Yeah, hi Sunil. I just wanted to ask, like in planning phase, like for agile, planning is also done like multiple times or just done like one time?
We will come to that part in later slides.
Okay.
Any other question related to Agile Manifesto?
Hi Sunil, are there any disadvantages of using
See, Agile model is essentially used for small to medium scale projects. So if it's a large scale project, there are certain disadvantages of using Agile. So essentially, you need to be very careful when you are using Agile in terms of delivery methodology. So one of the disadvantages you could say that since the documentation, this is my real time experience working in Agile model. So one of the disadvantages I could see is since the documentation is not comprehensive enough, there are many times that a requirement is you know, going back and forth for approval, for a final approval. And since we are having too much of individual interaction from business, the business users are also confused from a for a certain functionality, because they sometimes do not have that much bandwidth to respond to your queries in a timely manner. So these two could be considered as you know, some of the disadvantages in Agile. And third, I would say, since we are following multiple communication channels, like we are interacting over a particular tool like Jira, and then we are interacting over emails, so it goes very difficult for us to trace a particular requirement. So if there is a single point of you know, reference where we could trace the requirement, it would have been much easier. Since they encourage more collaboration, the collaboration has to be streamlined and channelized, which do not happen essentially in some of the projects.
Okay. And since like we don't know the you know, it's difficult to assess the requirements you know, during the you know, during the project, so don't you think that the cost would be also could be one of the disadvantages of using agile?
See, agile projects are essentially fixed bid projects. They do not have any such cost based disadvantage because they are mostly fixed bid projects. They are not in a T&M fashion. I haven't seen any, you know, agile projects which are in T&M way. So since it's a fixed bid project, cost is not a huge issue.
Okay.
One more thing, in the second point it says individual interactions. So team interactions are not part of the Agile Manifesto, or
yes, individual interaction means we have different ceremonies in Agile. There are essentially four ceremonies in Agile we would see in a bit. So it emphasizes more on individual interaction rather than following a process and tool, rather than following what is there in your contract or agreement that 3 days is your SLA, 7 days is your SLA. We do not have any such thing in Agile. You have to be more interactive and collaborative.
Okay.
Hello?
Yeah.
Hello, as you said, the agile projects are mostly fixed bid, right?
Mm-hmm.
So in fixed bid, the requirement doesn't change. So how does, I mean, it goes like customer can actually change the requirements in between?
No. There are two perspectives to it. Okay, In fixed bid project, it's true, the requirement do not change, but it's an engagement model. And agile is a what I would say implementation model. So model wise they differ. You cannot relate an engagement model with to an implementation model.
Okay, so are you trying to say that the requirements that are already fixed in fixed project, which is using agile methodology,
mm-hmm.
so in the same requirement there may be some changes?
No, what happens essentially in a fixed bid project is like the customer gives you a typical proposal. In proposal, your requirements are defined at a high level. Then after that, you start writing a business case wherein you outline the requirement. Okay. After that, you create a document wherein you give your understanding in and around requirement. It's not like that today customer gave you a sign off that, okay, it would be a fixed bid project, and tomorrow you would start gathering the requirement. It's not like that. There is a pre-analysis phase associated to every project which happens before it enters into an agile engagement.
Okay. But you said that in Agile Manifesto, the first point, customer collaboration, the customers can actually go into the sprint and change the requirement.
It depends. If the customer is a product owner, he can do so.
So that is what my question is actually. When the requirements are fixed, so how can the customer go back and change?
No. Requirements are fixed. Okay. But how we are delivering that particular requirement, that is not fixed. Customer cannot give a complete plan that, okay, we would be delivering this set of feature in next 3 months, the another set of feature next 3 months. He cannot give a fixed commitment towards it. Okay, so in that context, what you are saying is a fixed bid project is the total cost of the project. Within that total cost, what you would be delivering, that is something which is defined. But changing requirement doesn't mean that you would give anything out of that scope.
Okay,
because for every project there would be a scope. If say you want to build a banking system, so in that particular banking system there would be a scope that this particular application would be used in let's say North America. This particular application would be having 10 modules. This particular application would be having 3-4 sub modules. Now this is your scope of the application, which is defined in your fixed bid contract. But if you are asking for a change, so change doesn't mean that change would be out of the scope. The change has to be within the scope. Within the scope as in, if you are saying that, okay, I don't want this feature first, I want this particular feature first. That is a change requested, which a business user can do, which is possible in HR. You cannot say that, okay, this project was initially planned for North America, I want to do it for South America in the same cost. It is not possible. Whatever request you are whatever change request you are requesting, that has to be within the scope of the engagement. You cannot ask anything beyond the scope.
Okay, got it. So basically the requirement doesn't change.
Requirement doesn't change. Yes, the requirement doesn't change, but the implementation or other aspects of a requirement change.
Okay.
Now, coming to the 12th Agile principle. So every framework has certain principles associated with it. So we have 12 principles in Agile. First is constantly delight your customers. Constantly delight your customer as in when you are working in an agile engagement, when you are agreeing to customers change or you are responding to customer change, eventually it delights your customer. The customer is happy, and since you are accepting their inputs or accepting what they are requesting, anything that is pertaining to a particular implementation or particular observation, that essentially delights the customer. So as a business analyst, it is recommended that you also work on the improvement areas for your particular projects. Improvement areas as in, if let's say you are given activity that you have to gather requirements for 1 to 10 feature. So while you are gathering requirement, you could probably suggest your customer that, okay, basis on the on my analysis of this 1 to 10 requirements, I came up with this particular observation, and I feel if we tweak the requirement in this way, we could club some of the requirements, or the value that would be delivered to your end system would be more feasible and would be more logical. In this way, you could give them suggestion, or you could provide your observation to them, which ultimately delights your customer. Second pointer it talks about seeks continuous discovery and responding to evolving customer needs. Now, since the project is evolving, project as in the product is evolving in an agile environment, so you have to continuously discover some of the improvement areas. And if a customer is asking you for a particular what I would say feature, you should first understand why the customer is asking that particular feature. So as a business analyst, if your customer is asking to do X, you do not need to accept it as X. You have to brainstorm or cross question your customer, why do you want this X? If the answer is justified, if it is adding some value to the product, you could consider it or accept it. Otherwise, don't accept it. As a business analyst, it's your responsibility that whatever customer is asking you, you have to first assess it, that whether it is justified, it's logical, or it's valuable or not. If you feel that it is not valuable, you have to educate the customer over that particular piece, because I have seen many cases in my regular project wherein customer is asking any bullshit things. So you cannot agree to all those things, because customer do not have enough idea about what is happening inside the system. They would say something out of the box that I want this particular functionality, I saw this particular functionality in my competitor system, so I want to implement it. They may come to you with this illogical statement as well, but you need to assess it, whether your product actually be used in that particular context, like your customer's competitor are using it. If yes, what are the core areas your product would be using, would be used in, for that matter? You need to assess it, then only you have to convince your customer that, okay, if it is needed, then we can do it. If it is not needed, then there is no need to implement this functionality, because eventually these all things would add up cost to the customer. Cost as in, if let's say your engagement is of 12 months and if the project goes for 13 or 14 months, then the cost would be more for the customer, because in that way, as per your fixed price contract, it's a 12 months engagement. If it increases for another 2 months, then a thorough analysis would be conducted by your billing department, wherein what are the new features the customer has asked. Basis on that, they would be billed. So you have to keep the scope intact, that whatever customer is asking, he is asking within the scope. Nothing is beyond the scope. And if anything additional is asked, then that additional charge would be borne by the customer, even though if it's a fixed bid contract. Next is deliver meaningful outcomes frequently. So whatever you are delivering, any particular piece of code, it has to be meaningful. It has to add some value to the customer. Value to the customer as in, you cannot create a UI of a particular application and that UI is not at all functional. That is not meaningful to the customer. It has to have some set of validation in that particular UI, some set of logic. Maybe some crude operation has to be there, like you could save a particular record which you have inserted via UI, or edit a particular record. It has to be meaningful. You cannot deploy a code to the customer environment and ask them to test which is incomplete. So you have to ensure that whatever you are delivering, even though it's a frequent deliverable, it is meaningful. The fourth pointer talks about the primary measure of progress is customer for sorry, outcomes for our customers. So whatever your customer sees as a value, that is your primary measure of progress. So what happens essentially is like whenever this prioritization meeting happens, so the development team is very smart and they pick up the features which are very easy. But those easy features are not a value to a customer. So even though you are deploying 25 features which are easier against two features which are valuable, customer would give their preference to the valuable feature even though it's less in number. They don't see the quantity over here, they see the value what they are getting. Next, talk about maintain a constant pace and rhythm indefinitely. Now this pointer is like whenever you are starting with an agile engagement, there are essentially a series of sprint through which you would be delivering a piece of incremental system. So after every increment, your system gets built in bits and pieces. So when you are delivering this particular value to your customer in terms of code, you have to maintain a constant pace. So it shouldn't be like in this month's sprint, you gave them 15% of the application. In next month's sprint, you gave them 10% of the application. In another 1 month, you give them 5% of the application. So the value keeps on decreasing in this case. If we consider a case 2, wherein we gave them, in first month sprint, we gave them a 5% of application. In second month sprint, we gave them a 10% of application. In third month sprint, we gave them a 8% of application. So 5, 10, 8, it could be considered as a constant pace, or an increasing pace could be considered as constant pace, but it should not or never ever go in a decreasing manner, that you delivered a huge amount of features in first month, then comparatively smaller amount of feature, then in the next month comparatively smaller amount of feature. That is not allowed. It could fluctuate that in sprint one more features, sprint two average feature or medium size feature, sprint three again more feature. This could happen. Fluctuation could be considered, but at the end it has to give some value to the customer. Now 6 point talks about give continuous attention to excellence. Now what does this term excellence refer to? So excellence as in, like, we already know that in Agile we do not have enough comprehensive documentation. From a business analyst standpoint, we need to ensure that whatever requirements or whatever user stories we are writing, they are well understood by all of the users within that particular project. So even if a business user reads your user stories, he should be able to understand the user stories. You have to write it in that simple language, and you have to clearly define the scope of the story. Scope of the story as in the acceptance criteria in and around the story. What this story is intended for, who are the users who would be benefited from the stories, and what all things you need to capture in terms of measuring the completeness of this particular user story. You have to have complete attention to the excellence. Secondly, when it comes to the development team, since the development pace is very fast in Agile, after every 15 days or every 3 weeks or every 1 month, you have to give a delivery in terms of completion of your sprint. So you cannot compromise on the coding standard. For that context, the development team would ensure that whatever code they are writing, it meets the standard coding guidelines which are prescribed within an organization. And same thing goes for the QA team as well.
Hello?
Yeah.
I just want to ask, like, the selection criteria is being defined by BA or the head of BA, like project manager?
What selection criteria you are referring to?
For the user story?
User stories selection for development, you are saying?
Yeah. I mean, when the BA creates a user story, so for that, there may be a couple of selection criteria. So that is being defined by BA or someone else.
We'll come to that point in a while, how it is selected. Okay, coming to the seventh pointer, business and technology people work together as one team. So if you see agile model, we do not have that many taxonomy in and around who is sitting above whom. We only have three people, or rather three roles in agile: your scrum master, your product owner, and the development team or the scrum team. So we do not have any such huge level of resources in a typical scrum team. So here we have a right balance of business people and technology people. So product owner is essentially the business person. He represents the business, and the scrum team are the people who represents the technology side. And scrum master is a person who could be considered in a role of project manager, who manages these teams and the what I would say, the communication between your product owner and the scrum team. So the management part lies with the scrum team, the scrum master. The technological part lies with the scrum team, and the functional or the business part lies with the product owner. So these three teams, they work together as one team in terms of understanding and delivering features or functionalities in and around that particular product. Now coming to the next principle, it builds product around motivated, responsible adults and give them the freedom to learn and succeed. So essentially, motivation is something that is highly appreciated in Agile compared to the PMP model prescribed by PMI. So PMI model, it had, it did not had that much respect when it comes to the development team. It treated the developers as resources to whom you delegate your orders, and they have to follow your order. That is what PMI PMP talks about when it comes to project management. But in Agile, we never disrespect anyone. We value everyone's individual perspective, whether it's a developer, whether it's a business analyst, whether it's a QA person. If they say that they do not have bandwidth, or if they say that this functionality cannot be implemented by that particular person, and if that could be delegated to another person within that team, then you have to acknowledge it. You cannot go about criticizing them and dominating that particular person. No, since you have the needed capacity or the bandwidth, you have to do it. This is not allowed in Agile. So that's very clean and motivated environment that we follow in Agile. Next, it talks about communicate directly and honestly, and preferably face to face. So Agile encourages more face to face conversation rather than communicating through offline channels via email or anything, which would require typically 24 hours to 48 hours for response. So we encourage face to face communication over here in Agile. Next is simplify maximum amount of work not done. Like I said in this example, that if a person is not capable of picking up a particular user story because he is not that much well acquainted with that particular technology, we should give them that much time to research and help motivate and encourage him to develop it or delegate it to another person within the scrum team. We cannot hold back on that particular person and say, no, you have to develop it. In that case, what it would happen essentially is the amount of work not done may increase. So what we have to encourage in Agile is, it's not about completing the work or major chunk of work. We have to simplify the environment in such a way that even though the amount of work not done is at its maximum, but whatever minimum amount of work done we have delivered is meeting the values of the customer or meeting the expectation of the customer, and the deliverables are of high quality and is valuable. So that it talks about, you have to simplify things. You need not to focus on how much work is not done.
Hello?
Yeah.
So in that case, does the work get divided into other colleagues, or like it remains with the same?
Which case?
I mean, suppose there's a guy who's not that experienced, is not able to pick up the user story. So he's lagging behind the pace in comparison with other developers. So does his work get divided with among other team members, or like how does it?
It depends on the size of work. So if they feel that they are comfortable with the other team members, then they can pick up that particular person work. There is no hard and fast rule that you would specifically assign this particular work to them. So what happens in Agile is like, as a Scrum Master, okay, I'll come to that part in a while, or otherwise it would spoil the interest how things happen. Now, coming to the next part, work in self-organizing and cross-functional team. So in Agile, ideally it is expected that your team is co-located. It's not something that you are working in US and someone the other team members are in UK. It is not that much encouraged in Agile. The team has to be located in one single place. So in that manner, you could have more face-to-face communication, more individual interaction and collaboration. So that's the 11th point it talks about, work in self-organizing and cross-functional team. And finally, create a learning culture, share information transparently, inspect and tune behavior. Like I said, we have to respect each and every individual's perspective. We have to understand their viewpoint, and we have to share a learning culture. If you found something, then you should share it with the other people in and around that particular team. So these were the 12 principles on which your Agile or Scrum is based on. Now, if you see the variations in Agile, so under Agile umbrella, we have Scrum, Crystal, Kanban, Extreme Programming, then we have Dynamic System Development Method, we have Feature-Driven Development, Rational Unified Process, Lean, Disciplined Agile, Extended Agile, Safe Framework, Less Framework, all XYZ framework, they come under Agile umbrella. Now, each of these methodology have their own significance. For example, Less Framework, it is used for a project which is large in nature. Like I said in the earlier, someone asked me that Agile is used for small scale, sorry, Scrum is used for small to medium complexity project. If the project is more complex in nature, then we use less framework. And if the project is even more complex than that, then we use safe framework. It's a enterprise version of your regular Scrum framework, which is part of your Agile. So if we see the Scrum life cycle, we have four milestone in Scrum life cycle. First, we have planning, then we have staging, then we have development, and finally we have release. Unlike your waterfall, we do not have that many phases. We have only four phases over here. So in planning phase, what we do, we vision out or we find out what are the expectation and what is the initial funding needed. Now, when I say initial funding, what do you understand?
Mama.
Hello.
Maybe the initial resource needing for the planning phase.
Okay. See what happens, like I explained you that I think someone is not on mute. Herlin, can you please go on mute? I'm hearing a lot of noise. Thank you. Okay. See,
Yes, sorry, now I'm on the mute. Sorry.
Remember I told you that Agile is essentially, sorry, Scrum is essentially used in a case when you are doing a product development. So when you are starting with a product, what happens is you come up with a particular product vision that what this product is all about, who are the potential users of this product, What is the market segment you are projecting this particular software product? You have any such XYZ number of vision in your mind before you start developing your particular product. So in the planning phase, you tend to gather those visions, essentially those ideas. And at later stages, you go about creating those ideas from idea creation, implementation. From idea creation to implementation, you start from planning phase, then staging, then development, and finally your ideas are created and it is ready for your end users. So in planning phase, essentially you vision those ideas. What are the ideas that you could deploy in that particular product, or what are the features? So idea is nothing but a particular feature in a particular software product. So you vision those features in planning phase, and in your vision or in your idea creation, you set out certain expectation. Okay, if I create this particular feature, then this would be the benefits. So benefits are nothing but your expectation. So vision would give a outcome as idea, and expectation would give the outcome as benefits. So ideas and benefits would together contribute towards your product success. Now in planning phase, you essentially tend to capture these things. Now the third aspect in planning phase is your initial funding. So initial funding is like, if you are working in a particular startup, you may most often come with this particular initial funding term, wherein they would set a particular funding budget for a particular project, that 2 million is the budget for your particular project. Now you decided how to utilize this 2 million. So that is what you are going to plan in this particular planning phase. So once your budget is exhausted, you could reach out to your business sponsor and ask for additional set of funding, which is in the next planning phase. So essentially these particular four phases, they would be repeated in the next planning phase. Am I confusing you people, or you are getting it?
Can you explain the funding?
See, funding is like when you are working in a particular product, you tend to secure an initial funding from your business sponsor. So let's say they give you an initial funding of 2 million. So depending on the cost associated, the development cost, the QA cost, you have to decide for how long you would be using that particular funding. You would be having a plan. So there would be a point of time wherein your funding budget is exhausted, the initial funding budget. So in that case, what you would do to keep the project continue or going on, you would ask the business sponsor for the next set of funding. Essentially in startup companies, it happens like that. They come up with one set of funding. Once their funding budget is exhausted, they reach out to their business sponsor and ask for a next set of funding, which again, keeps them active and in business for another 1 to 2 years. So every 1 to 2 years, they ask for a set of funding, basis on which they keep on continuing improving their particular product. Now, after you have completed your planning, you go with this staging phase. Staging is the phase wherein we as a business analyst would identify requirement and do all the necessary set of prioritization in and around the requirement, basis on which are the most needed feature, which are the least needed feature, which are the features which could be developed at a later point of time. We prioritize the requirements, and then we also plan the cycles. Now in Agile, cycles are called as sprints. So sprints are essentially the time frame wherein which you decide on the basis of which you would be delivering a piece of code in incremental manner. So let's say you decide a sprint cycle to be of 15 days. That means after every 15 days, you have to deliver some functionalities or some feature to that particular product or particular system. So that kind of planning has to be done in the staging phase, the requirements and how you would be delivering, what should be the size of sprint, 15 days or 3 weeks or 4 weeks. It essentially do not go beyond 4 weeks. Usually, companies follow a 2 to 3 week cycle. They do not go even for 1 month. So why they keep shorter cycle? Any idea? Why not a 3 months or 4 months cycle? Or for that matter, 1 month cycle? Why they keep between 2 weeks to 3 weeks only? Any idea what could be the advantage of it?
So we can move to next feature. Fastly.
Okay, let me give you a hint. let me give you a hint over here. I developed a feature, and that feature is working as per the user story. But customer feels that they have some additional inputs for that particular feature. Or additional requirement for that particular feature.
So the advantage would be that if they need to add something in that particular feature, they can do it.
Exactly. So let's say, So let's say a particular feature you have developed in 15 days and you give it to the customer and it is working as per the user story. Now within that 15 days while the feature is being developed, customer came into a perception that okay, there are some additional points that I missed out. So what customer would tell you that in the next sprint cycle, can you include this? So what you would do after the sprint in which you delivered the initial feature, you would say, okay, after 15 days, I would give you the additional features or the additional set of inputs you gave us. So this way, you are not only delighting the customer request for change, you are also building a better system as per customer's need. So essentially the turnaround time around 1 month has decreased to only 15 days. So that's the reason why companies or project practices are 15 days to 3 weeks sprint, so that they get earlier deliverables of their expected outcomes.
Hello.
Yeah.
So with feature you don't mean sprint cycle, right? The sprint cycle.
Yeah, sprint cycle is different. It's not you know, all the features at the end would be tagged to a particular cycle, but sprint cycle is more from a deliverable perspective and feature are more from a requirement perspective.
Okay, the sprint cycle may have more than one feature.
Yes, absolutely. It has to have multiple features. Next comes your development phase, wherein you implement system ready for release in each sprint. So after every sprint, you get a better version of the system, a more number of feature compared to the earlier sprint cycle. And finally, you have release, wherein all your code are deployed in any XYZ environment. Remember, in Agile also, we have different environment, like we have local development environment, we have QA environment, SIT environment, system integration testing environment, then your what I would say user acceptance testing environment, and your what I would say production environment. In Agile also we have this deployment environment. Now these are the three essential roles in a typical Scrum team. So we have a product owner who gives the product a vision, a direction, and who contributes in a functional perspective to the overall product. Then we have a Scrum master. You can think of him as a project manager who collaborates with the product owner and the Scrum team and who understand the roadblocks or challenges within the Scrum team. So whatever challenges Scrum team is facing, he has to inform to the Scrum master that they are facing the challenges. And then we have a Scrum team. In Scrum team, it could be a combination of your developers, it could be a testers, or any XYZ person who are there in a particular project. Now, where do business analysts come into the picture? Which role is more appropriate for a business analyst to play out of these three? Any idea? Okay, any other views?
Maybe working with product owner.
Yes. A business analyst role is more relevant to a product owner because product owner is the person who keeps the accountability of the functionalities that are part of a particular system. And business analyst is a functional representative of the business. So in that context, product owner is the much, what I would say, suitable role to be played by a business analyst. So in most project, what happens is like, especially in a less framework or in a safe framework wherein the project is very large in nature, the business analysts are given the role of a product owner for a particular piece of what I would say module or epic. So they do not have they are business analysts, but their role is of a product owner who prioritizes the requirement, who captures the requirement. Now my next question is, who all are authorized to write a user story in a particular agile project? Who all can write user stories?
DA, Scrum Masters, and QA leads.
Okay. Any other views?
So everybody can write user stories.
Yes, absolutely. Everyone can write. Yes, everyone can write user stories in Agile. So functional user stories is something product owner would write. Process oriented user stories is something Scrum Master can write. And technical or what I would say task level user stories is something your development team or Scrum team can write. In addition to that, if the business sponsor feel that there are certain additional requests that they need to make, in that case the business sponsor can also write the user story. So anyone who is involved in this particular engagement, whether it's a business sponsor or your program manager, program director, they are free to write user stories unless and until they are not part of the project. Whoever is part of the project can write a user story apart from these three roles. So this is the Scrum process. We have a product backlog wherein we have a list of user stories. Now, within that particular product backlog, we would be having a sprint backlog, which is essentially a subset of your product backlog. And then we go on conducting 2-week sprint cycle. And ultimately, after 2 weeks, we get a product increment. Now, product backlog would be having multiple user stories. Okay. And when you are planning a particular sprint and creating your sprint backlog, you would be selecting few of the user stories out of the product backlog in that particular sprint planning meeting. So rest all stories would lie over there. Once you are completed with those user stories, you would and they are delivered, you would go back to the product backlog again and pick up user stories basis on your capacity of the team. Capacity is like available bandwidth within a particular team. Let's say it's a team of 5 people. So per day their allocation is 5 people, 5 into 8 is 40 hours. So 40 hours stories they would be picking up from a product backlog. So 40 hours into 40 2 weeks, that is 10 days, that is 400 hours. So anything that is not completed within this 2 week sprint cycle, if there are some unfinished items are there in the current ongoing sprint, that would again be put back in the product backlog and again prioritized when you are planning for the next sprint cycle. So this way the cycle goes on until the project gets delivered completely. And within that, after every 24 hours, that is every day, you have to conduct a daily scrum. So daily scrum is essentially signifies that what you did yesterday, what you did today, what you are going to do today, and what are any roadblocks or challenges that you are facing? So that is something your Scrum Master needs to understand from the Scrum team. And he has to take the necessary action in and around it by further coordinating with the concerned authority around your roadblocks or challenges. Now, there are essentially four types of ceremonies in HR. One is your daily stand-up, then there is your sprint planning, then there is sprint review, and then there is sprint retrospective. We'll see one by one now. So daily stand-up meeting is conducted daily. So there are essentially three main questions that you need to ask in daily stand-up meeting. That is, what I did yesterday, what I'll do today, what is in it, what's in my way, and are there any challenges or roadblocks that you are facing? Only three questions. And there are certain rules that you need to follow when you are conducting a stand-up meeting. The meeting has to happen on the same place, same time. It has to be maximum 15 minutes. It has to be facilitated by your Scrum Master, and your entire team should be present. And there would be only three questions asked to each participant. These are some standard rules which you need to follow when you are attending a stand-up meeting or Scrum meeting, daily Scrum. Next is your sprint planning. So, like I said, after every 15 days, let's say we decided a sprint cycle to be of 15 days. So, after every 15 days, we go to the product backlog and we tend to pick up the items which are prioritized, and we discuss those items in sprint planning meeting, and then we create our sprint backlog basis on the team's capacity or team's bandwidth, the overall team's bandwidth. And this process is repetitive every 15 days as decided by the initial sprint cycle, that it would be 15 days or it would be 3 weeks or 1 month for that matter. You have to plan this sprint meeting after that much frequent, after a period of that particular frequency, 3 weeks or 4 weeks or 15 days. Now, my question is that to you all, in a product backlog, there is a concept called as grooming. Is anyone aware about what is grooming? And essentially, a business analyst is accountable for doing grooming of the user stories. Hello.
Hi. It kind of like reviewing the all the tasks like which we have to do, or what is like everything in the plate.
Okay. Any other views?
Or we can like set the priority, like which tasks need to be done on the priority and which are not.
Okay. Okay. See, in the start of this session, we came to a conclusion that requirements are not clear in Agile right at the time of beginning. So when we are writing user stories, it is not complete at that point of time. Okay. So the user stories would be having certain statuses like in progress or pending review, or it could have a status like pending query, more information needed, of that sort. So grooming is like to revisit this user stories and check how many of these user stories are marked as complete and could be taken up in a sprint planning session so that they could be assigned to a particular development team. So grooming is essentially to revisit this user story and check how many user stories are complete for development from a planning perspective. So this grooming typically happens before sprint planning meeting. We have a, let's say we are using a tool like Jira, and we have wrote 50 user stories. So every user story would be having an associated status like pending query or pending approval or complete or awaiting response from business, these kind of statuses. So we would pull a Jira extract and see how many of them are marked as done. Now, whatever user stories are marked as done, we would go on prioritizing those user stories. Out of those completed user stories, how many user stories are of more valuable to the business? How many are high priority? And basis on that, we assign those user story with a particular sprint basis on the team's capacity or bandwidth. So those all things happen prior to sprint planning meeting. And in sprint planning meeting, we essentially discuss on the user stories which are completed and ready for development. Next, we have sprint review meeting. Now, what happens in a sprint review meeting? Now, sprint planning meeting is conducted before the start of the sprint, and sprint review meeting is conducted after the sprint has been completed. So there are certain stakeholders who would be part of this sprint planning, sprint review meeting. They would be having Scrum Master, your product owner, your Scrum team, your stakeholders, sponsor, customers, and everyone. So essentially what we do in sprint review meeting is we demo the system to the customer, and we understand, basis on the number of features we have given to the customer or delivered to the customer, how the customer is perceiving those features. Is that adding the value to the customer or not? We tend to explore those kind of questions when we are giving the demo to that particular system. Remember, demo is also given by a business analyst or a product owner to the end customer after the end of each sprint cycle. So you would be giving the demo to the customer. At the same time, you are also collecting feedback from the customer around their observation for the demoable system. So after that, they go on testing. And if they feel that there are some additional things that needs to be done, they would write a related user stories for it and assign it to you. Else, they would accept it and they would mark the status as ready for production deployment, wherein the end user starts using the particular feature or functionality. Next, we have sprint retrospective meeting. Now, sprint review is for your customers. You would be giving a demo to your customer. Now, what happens in sprint retrospective meeting? Now, sprint retrospective meeting is also conducted after the sprint has completed. In that, you tend to sit with your Scrum team, your Scrum Master, and your product owner, and you tend to explore certain questions like what went well in the entire sprint, what do you feel was very good in this particular sprint, and what are the areas of improvement that you feel could be incorporated in the upcoming sprint. And third is what we could what was a roadblock that has to be taken care of in the next sprint. So these kind of improvement discussion essentially happens in a sprint retrospective meeting. So essentially it's around 1 hour meeting, and within that particular 1 hour meeting you tend to explore certain improvement observation against the sprint that has been completed with the sprint that is going to start in a couple of in the next week. So essentially they are conducted on Fridays, and the impediments which you have observed, they get implemented from the sprint that is starting from Monday onwards. So these are certain differences between sprint review meeting and sprint retrospective meeting. So here the attendees would be development team, Scrum team, product owner. Here the same number of attendees. Now it is towards the end of end of a sprint or a milestone. It is always conducted towards the end of a sprint. So we have an option in sprint review towards a milestone. Like I said, in a particular project, there could be certain milestone. Again, it's an optional, but in regular practice, it happens towards the end of the particular sprint. So duration wise, it's 30 to 60 minutes. Here it is 60 minutes. Okay, everyone clear so far about the four Scrum ceremonies before I begin with the backlogs? Hello.
The time you specified, like 30 to 60 minutes, is it like hard rule that it should be 60 minutes, or because it can be longer, right? The sprint meetings.
It depends on the complexity of the project that has sorry, complexity of the features that has been delivered. So in sprint review meeting, if the nature of the feature is complex, then in that case it may exceed as well. But in general practice, in Agile, we tend to follow a time box culture. So all the meetings follow a time box culture, whether it's a sprint review meeting, daily scrum, or sprint retrospective, or sprint planning, we follow a time box culture in Agile. It may exceed, but in regular practice, you have to ensure it shouldn't exceed, because that ultimately affects everyone's productivity hours.
Yeah. Okay.
Okay. So in Agile, we essentially have three types of backlog. We have a product backlog, we have a release backlog, and then we have a sprint backlog. Now we have seen product backlog and sprint backlog. Now what is release backlog then? So release backlog is like a particular version increment of a particular system. So sprint backlog is like every 15 days you are delivering something, which may be complete feature, which may be an incomplete feature. But release backlog ensures that a complete feature is developed and deployed to the end customer. So a release backlog can span around 4 to 5 sprint cycles. So maybe this month you are giving 2 sprint deliverable, next month you are giving another 2 sprint deliverable, that's total 4 sprint cycles. So those 4 sprint cycle would be one particular release increment of a particular version, that is version 1 of a particular system, version 2 of a particular system. Now release backlog can span a year as well. Like in case of your Android system, every year you get an release a release increment, like version 7.0, version 8.0. so that is considered as a release. But in between there are certain security patches, then there are certain some XYZ patches, network improvement, or any security updates. So those could be considered as sub-release backlog, which could span multiple sprint backlog. So release is something that is a major change to a particular software compared to a sprint backlog. Now coming to product backlog, it is created and prioritized by your product owner. Your release backlog, product owner selects feature for your next release of a particular release, and sprint backlog is something your development team decides what they need to assign it to themselves. One more thing that I want to highlight over here, whenever you are doing a sprint planning, you don't assign things to the development team. It's development team members who decide that which feature they are confident with. A scrum master or a product owner has no rights to assign a particular feature to a developer. It's developer who would say that, okay, I am confident with this feature, so I'll pick it up for development. So that's a what I would say, encouraging and motivating culture that you need to embrace in Agile environment. Okay, any question around product release and sprint backlog? Anyone? Yes. No, that is also a release backlog, version 7.1.0 or version 7.1.2. But changing from version 6 to 7 is a major release. Okay, changing from version 7 to 7.1 or 7.2, it's a minor release. So release also has some size, whether it's a major release or a smaller release. But ultimately, it increments the entire product. It doesn't increment the feature. When you are talking about release, it's incrementing a product. When you are talking about sprint, it's incrementing a feature. So that's the difference. See, if you are improving a UI for a particular system, okay, I'm just giving an example. If you are improvising a UI or the user experience for a particular system, so if you feel that the functionality is complete, it's not incomplete, okay, because sprint doesn't mean that the entire feature is delivered in one sprint itself. In order to deliver an entire feature, it would take multiple sprints. Until and unless that particular functionality is not complete, irrespective of how many sprint cycle it is taking, we cannot consider that particular feature as complete. So in order to mark that particular feature as complete, we need to have a particular release. And that's why we use release backlog, which would span multiple sprint backlog to ensure the entire functionality is working end to end. Okay. Now next we have Scrum story points. Okay, so we'll take a quick 5 minute break over here. When I come back, I'll explain you what is story point and how to estimate. Okay, now story point is essentially a technique wherein we estimate the size, associate a particular point to a user story. When we write a user story, what happens essentially is like it varies around multiple factors, like ease of development, how easy is it to develop this particular functionality or a particular piece of feature, whether it's very easy or it's hard or it's very difficult. One parameter is that. Second parameter is that how many hours of effort it would take in order to develop it. Now complexity is different thing, and hours to complete that particular feature is different thing. There may be a case that the functionality is very simple, but it would take 2 to 3 days to develop. So basis on these particular parameters, we define the user stories basis on the size of t-shirt, like extra small, small, medium, large, extra large, and associate them with a particular story point. Like very small user story, extra small would be 1, then small could be 2, then 3, then 5, then 8. It is a Fibonacci sequence that we follow. That is, final conclusion is 20. Now when we are estimating this story points, it's not 1% decision. There would be entire agile team who would be sitting in that particular room, and they would be assessing and evaluating a story point to that particular feature or particular user story. Now before assessing and associating a story to a particular a story point to a particular user story, there is something called as planning poker, which the development team plays. Now what is that? Is like, so everyone is able to see this notepad that I have opened.
Yes.
There, let's say we consider there are 5 developers. And there are 3 features. Okay, let's say feature 01. Feature 02. Now let's consider a case that I am the scrum master who is facilitating this sprint planning meeting. So what I would ask developer 1, I would ask developer 1 that what do you feel about feature 1. So developer 1, basis on his idea, he would say, okay, it's an extra small feature 1. Okay. Now developer 2, I ask the same question. Developer 2 says, okay, it's small. Now developer 3 says it's extra small. Developer 4 says again it's small. And developer 5 says it's again small. So I would average out their viewpoint and see that what maximum people feels about that particular feature one. So when I averaged it out, so the story came out to be small in size. So basis on that, extra small is 1, small is 2. So I would assign the story point as 2 to it. Same way, same process I would follow for feature 2 as well. And basis on that, I would assign it story point. So it's not one person's decision that what point it should be assigned to. We have to accumulate the viewpoints of each and every participants of the Scrum team, that what they feel about. Now what would happen after the story points are associated to a particular feature? Any idea? Now how this developer should go about picking this feature? Should the Scrum Master assign it to them, or they would pick it up as per their convenience?
Yeah,
they will pick it.
They will pick up according to the complexity of the feature.
Yes, basis on their gut feeling, basis on their ease of implementing the feature, they themselves would pick it up, and that would be the final story point and final effort decided for that particular user story. So this is what we do in a particular sprint planning session. Next, we have something called as burn down chart. So within the 15 days, your sprint starts. So there is a bunch of user stories which are there allocated to the entire team. So as a product owner, I want to see what is the progress of the team. For that reason, I would look into the burn down chart. So every agile project management suite, whether it's Jira or Visual Studio Online or Microsoft Deep Foundation Server, they has this functionality to visualize the team's burn down chart, wherein it would show at the start of the sprint how many user stories were there, after 2 days what is the progress, and towards the end what is the progress. Now it isn't a mandate that all of the user stories which was picked up during the start of the sprint has to be completed, but it is advised that it has to be completed. There may be unfinished item as well, so that progress we would able to visualize via burn down chart in agile. Next, we have something called a sprint velocity. Now what is sprint velocity? Sprint velocity is like sprint one we have started, we have committed. Committed is like how many user stories we are picking up, and delivered is like how many user stories we have completed and delivered. So there is a two graph which denotes it. Now sprint velocity is like after every sprint, what is the progress of the entire team. So let's say if a team has 3 completed sprint of 65, 75, 100 story points, then the team velocity at that point is plus summation of all 3 sprints story points divided by 3. So if there are 4 sprints wherein the team has developed 4 different average of story points, that would be 4 sprints cumulative divided by 4. If it is 5, 5 sprints cumulative divided by 5. That is how you calculate the velocity. Velocity as in at what pace the development team is delivering value to the customer. So that is how we calculate the sprint velocity at any given point of time in a particular agile project. Now, who would be in need to calculate velocity? Who is the person who would be in need of visualizing the velocity? Any idea who it would be?
Scrum Master.
Yes, Scrum Master and your product owner as well in that case. So they have the entire accountability. Scrum Master do not have the entire accountability. The product owner has the accountability to understand and analyze whether my team is working very fast, or they are average, or they are slow. In that case, they would be keen to see the sprint velocity. Now, next concept is your capacity planning. So capacity planning is very simple. What we do over here is we count the number of resources in our team, they are working hours, and what is the period of sprint cycle, and we just multiply and summate, do a average out of it. For example, these are the team members, and this are the percentage of their availability, and these are the hours they have contributed. So total capacity of the entire team for a particular sprint is 124.16. Now, let me ask you a question over here. In the context of capacity planning, or in the context of what I would say, sprint as well as capacity. Now, let me give you a scenario. Now, this sprint cycle was completed on time, and the customer has asked for additional features, okay, in the next upcoming sprint cycle. And the sprint cycle is decided as of 15 days. Okay. So, although the days are 15 in the upcoming sprint cycle, I do not have the necessary capacity or the necessary number of people to work on the customer's request. What should I do in that case?
Can you please repeat?
Okay. Okay, let me put it in notepad. So let's say there are two sprints. Okay. Sprint one, that is complete, and it was of 200 hours. Now, sprint two is proposed, which is coming to us, and customer has requested some additional feature. Now, my sprint cycle is of 15 days in both the cases, and customer has requested for deliverables which exceeds the 15 days timeline. What should I do in that case? I have to deliver it.
Put more people on the team.
Yeah, adding more resources.
Yes, absolutely. So in that case, what has changed? Has the sprint changed or the capacity changed?
The capacity has
changed. Yes. Yes, exactly. If someone asks you this question, that what's the difference between sprint planning and capacity planning, the right and obvious answer is, sprint once decided, the cycle cannot change. It would be 15 days only. But capacities can change depending on the bandwidth. For that matter, if the work hours, the efforts are less, we can remove some of the resources from the team as well. So capacity is very flexible. So sprint you cannot change, but capacity you can change. Next is definition of done. Now, who writes the definition of done? Any idea whether it's BA, QA, product owner, Scrum Master, or Scrum team?
I get the QA.
But we do not have any role for QA, if you see in Scrum. No.
Scrum Master?
Scrum Master do not write definition of done. See, definition of done is something that has to be signed off from the Scrum team or the developers. If you see the checklist over here, unit test passed, code reviewed, acceptance criteria met, functional test passed, non-functional requirements met, product owner accepted the user story. So essentially, these are accountability of a developer or the Scrum team. So always Scrum team would write definition of done. But how do the development team conclude that a particular user story is complete and he marks it as done? What is the source of information from where he would conclude that the user story is complete and he would complete this checklist? What is that source of information? It is there in user story only, to give you a hint.
From the sprint plan, or we can say like from Jira?
No. Developers would always conclude whether a user story is complete or not basis on acceptance criteria. So every user stories would be having an acceptance criteria. So acceptance criteria is nothing but a benchmark that is used for evaluating whether the needed functionality is complete or not. Basis on acceptance criteria, the development team or scrum team would conclude that a particular user story is complete or done. So there are two things. Acceptance criteria is something the product owner would write when he is writing the user stories, and it should come from the user story owner. For that matter, who has written the user story, he has to write the acceptance criteria. And definition of done is something that would come from the development team. Now, we have seen the sprints usually starts from sprint 1, sprint 2, sprint 3, and there on. Now, what is sprint 0? Any idea? Obviously, the description is there on screen, but any rough idea what is sprint 0?
All the initial planning.
Yes. So, essentially what happens is, like, in a particular project we have many other needs as well, like setting up the project environment, procuring the software licenses, and installing the system, and creating the initial plan for the sprint cycles. So all those initial pre-project activities would be taken care in sprint zero. So some of the organization, some of the project, they don't see a value in sprint zero. They see that these are infrastructure related activities, and there is no such visible results that could be projected to the business or client as a value. But there is still a value. Some organization, they give much emphasis on sprint zero and project to the end, the business or the clients, that this is still valuable. So sprint zero is essentially part of every agile project. Some openly committed, but some do not accept it as valuable. After that, there are certain scrum values. Like I already said, you have to respect everyone. You have to focus on what you are delivering. You have to be open on what you are communicating to the other. You have to show your commitment. If you have picked up a user story, you have to complete it as a developer. You have to show some courage in terms of exceeding the expectation of your business stakeholder in terms of adding value to the customers. Okay, any questions, anyone on Agile framework so far? Anything I missed out you would like to know? Okay, so the features, epics, sub features, how to write user stories, how to write acceptance criteria, the 10 different ways of writing user stories. This is something that I am going to cover in Saturday's session when I explain you about how to write requirements and also educate you about what are the core types of requirement categories. That time I would explain these things. Apart from that, the entire framework, do you have any question in Agile? Okay. So should we start with the other framework, Extreme Programming? Okay. Now, what do you understand by extreme programming? It's again a part of Agile framework only, but what is it? What do you think at a very high level, what it could be? Okay.
Maybe a lot of emphasis is given in the development phase.
Yes, absolutely. So here, what emphasis is given more towards the development approach. Because if we see the business analyst role, he do not add that much value in terms of delivering a particular piece of functionality. A business analyst are business representative, they say what business is. But who actually adds values to a project is the development team. They develop a particular system basis on which whatever monetary benefits they have realized, the business and cashes those opportunity. Now, what they realized of late is that they should come up with a framework wherein they are more focused towards the programming aspect or the development aspect to a particular approach, and it has to be agile in nature. So they leveraged agile framework, some of the core principles, and they created a framework which is more which put more emphasis on the development team rather than all other counterparts. So what happened in that phase is, like, we have these things. We have a release plan, we have an iteration plan, we have an acceptance test, stand-up meeting, pair negotiation, unit testing, pair programming, and coding. So in development model, which is in extreme programming model, which is more focused towards the development aspect, it has these many phases. So we have release plan, which takes months to create. Then we have iteration plan, which has weeks, which takes usually weeks to complete. Then we have acceptance test, which usually completes within some days. Then we have stand-up meeting, which essentially completes in one day. Then we have pair negotiation, which completes essentially in hours. Then we have unit test, which executes in minutes. And then we have pair programming, which executes in certain seconds. And then we get the final code. After 1 month cycle, again, this thing is repeated. After another 1 month, this thing is repeated. So we see that stand-up meeting, then release plan, these are leveraged from agile framework. Then this timelines, months, weeks, days, 1 day, hours, minutes, they are again leveraged from agile framework. But what are the new addition over here is acceptance testing, then your pair negotiation, unit testing, pair programming, and coding, which are very exclusive to the development team. Now, what happens in your acceptance test? So, like I said, we would be having certain acceptance criteria in and around those requirements. So, rather than having a QA person to manually do those testing or execute those test cases, why not create a suite wherein we would be writing the code to execute those test cases? So essentially what they do over here is they write the acceptance test cases via code. Okay, so these test cases, once they have completed the functionality, they execute those test cases in the form of unit testing. So multiple unit test cases contributes to one particular acceptance test. So unit test is like testing a system from all possible perspective. Like, it could be a positive test case, it could be a negative test case, depending on the number of acceptance test criteria you have identified. So there, let's say there are 10 unit test cases. Those 10 unit test cases would contribute to one single feature level acceptance test cases. Then we have a concept of pair negotiation. So pair negotiation is something like multiple developer would be there in one particular team. So to every developer, their code is like a Bible to them. You cannot, they are under a perception that whatever they have written, that is absolutely correct. And it's of high quality. But what if we bring another perspective with that particular team and ask another developer in the same team to review that particular code? So the way he perceives the code or he sees the code would be different from this particular developer who has actually written the code. So what we do over there is we do a pair negotiation wherein the other developer would suggest him some recommendation or would suggest him some improvement basis on which he has to code. And the same thing is for your pair programming. Now, pair programming is something wherein one particular feature is being developed by two, three, developers in parallel. If the feature is of 3 months, they could deliver that particular feature in 1 month if they distribute or pair up those particular feature within the development. So that is, it refers to your pair programming. So pair programming, once it is completed, it doesn't take much time to integrate, and within minutes it is integrated, or within particular fraction of seconds they are integrated. So there is a concept of code merging which exists, wherein multiple developers write their code in their local environment, and the DevOps team, the deployment team, they merge those codes and deploy it as one particular feature, and the user is ready to start. Now, this particular model, what do you think? Do business analysts have a specific role to play? Because we have all the requirements, we have the release plan, we have the iteration plan. We are emphasizing more on coding standards, coding automated test cases. So do you think BA has a role to play in this environment?
Maybe in between the multiple releases, the BA may have a role to play.
Okay, I'll park that question for a while and we'll see it towards the end. Okay, so why is it called extreme at the first place? So since we write unit tests before programming and keep all of the tests running at all times, the unit test cases are automated, which reduce the cost of the QA team. So they write the unit test cases before the program. Now this unit test cases are again automated and programmed. They start with simple design and just enough to code the feature at hand and redesign when required. So whatever initial things are needed, they just start with those basic elements. Then they do programming pairs, like with two programmers at one screen, taking turns to use the keyboard. While one of them is at the keyboard, the other constantly reviews and provides input. So this is the case when you have your programming team or the development team co-located in one place. But if it's a different time zone, then they ultimately get their share of system usage within a 24 hours window. And they can extend it into a distributed model as well. One feature can be broken down into four parts, and four people can work in four different local machines to develop a particular functionality. So that's pair programming, which again saves some cost to the project. Then they integrate and test the whole system several times a day. Now, how is it possible if you would have employed a full-time QA resource who is doing manual testing to test the same piece of functionality or the whole system several times in a day? It's practically not possible. But with extreme programming, it is possible. Since all of the testing unit test cases are automated, they just need to click a button and all the test cases are executed and a report is generated how many are passed and how many are failed. So that way, it adds value to the project. It puts a minimal working system into production quickly and upgrading it whenever required. So since there are multiple tests conducted throughout the day, the code is of high quality and it could be promoted to the production environment as quickly when compared to your regular other frameworks, which involves manual QA effort. Next, it keeps the customer involved all the time and obtaining constant feedback. Now, essentially what happens in extreme programming, in agile case, we do a release after every 15 days. But in extreme programming case, we do a release every 24 hours or 48 hours. So that is more fast than agile, because we do not need any QA to do a quality assurance over there. We have already executed our test cases and test plans. So why do we need 15 days of time? It's better to develop and build it within 24 or 48 hours time window. So in that way, the delivery cycle are also less compared to your Scrum method. Now, there are certain things that you need to take into consideration when you are adopting extreme, like code reviews are effective, then testing is effective, there is a continuous regression and testing since all of the test cases are automated. design is effective as everybody's need to do refactoring daily. Now, what is refactoring? What do you understand by the term refactoring? It's a programming term, but maybe someone of you have some idea. Okay, let me give you a hint. Have you ever heard any time so far that the code is taking longer time to execute? So we should revisit the code and see if it could be executed from, let's say, 25 seconds to within 10 seconds. So what we are doing essentially over there.
The structure of the code.
Yes. So essentially we are refactoring the code over there. So refactoring doesn't mean that you change the let's say 100 line of code to 50 line. It doesn't mean refactoring. Refactoring is like eliminating the unnecessary execution, unnecessary codes that contributes towards the longer execution of a particular feature or functionality. Because programming, how it works is like, when you write a code, it goes on executing line by line all the codes. So in between those lines, there are certain unwanted code, which are not read, not needed for that functionality to be executed. So refactoring essentially eliminates those unnecessary code, and we get a clean code, which takes less amount of time when it comes to execution. So in extreme programming, we ensure that the code is refactored, let's say every 10 days, or maybe if you are incrementing or versioning a particular feature, after every versioning, you ensure that the code is refactored so that it do not execute for a longer period of time. Then it has integration testing, like since you are developing, multiple developers are developing on a particular single feature in four different local machines, it's very important that you do an integration testing wherein you integrate those four pieces of code in order to execute a single functionality. And then we have short iterations, which we have already discussed, 24 hours to 48 hours. Now, unlike Scrum, we have five values for extreme programming. And five principles. So those values are communication, simplicity, feedback, courage, respect. As respect is one of the important pillar in all of the agile frameworks, whichever agile framework you consider, these values may not change. The wordings may change, but the values won't change. Then we have extreme programming principle, like we get instant feedback from the customer, we work towards simplicity, the change is incremental, and we get a quality of work. So we have these activities within extreme programming. We code, test, listen to the customer, and then again design. And then again we repeat. Code, test, listen, and design. Now these are some of the extreme programming practices. Planning poker, I have already explained you how it works in the agile context. We have short releases. Now this is where the business analysts contribute in your extreme programming. In deciding the metaphor, the domain elements. So domain elements, like if a particular functionality is there, whatever domain related functionality or whatever domain related aspects would be there, that is something a business analyst needs to contribute in extreme programming project. So although it's not a larger role to play, but yes, BA has some role to play in extreme programming. Then we have simple design, testing, refactoring, pair programming, ownership, 40 hour per week culture, then on-site customer coding standards, and so on. So these are the activities your business people would contribute, and these are the activities your technical people would contribute when they are doing a planning game. Like business people would give the scope, the priority, the release, wherein they would be including 2-3 user stories in that particular release and saying that this particular user story would be having this particular user story is to be delivered, and what are the dates of the releases. This is something the business people would decide, and BA would work in this particular scope with the business people, and technical people would decide the estimate. So how long will the feature take to implement, the consequences, the processes, and the detailed schedule? Remember, in extreme programming, impact analysis has a very important role to play, because since the system is being altered every single day, you have to know the impact of the newer functionality that you are incorporating or bringing into the system. You need to do a thorough impact analysis when you are dealing with extreme programming. So, which are the typical roles in extreme programming? In Scrum, we saw there is Scrum team, there is a Scrum master, and then there is product owner. In extreme programming, we have these roles. We have developer, we have customer, we have managers, and then we have coach. Now, coach can alternatively be played by your business analyst as well. So, coach is nothing but a fusion role of your Scrum master and your product owner. So towards the end of extreme programming, these are the artifacts that needs to be developed: your user stories, your acceptance test cases, your estimates, release plan, iteration plan, your task cards, your design cards, your unit test cases, and your customer and developer communication records. Now remember, here they don't say it as user stories, they say it as user story cards, and they don't say it as task, they say it as task card. Unlike Scrum, things are same, but only they use the term cards in front of it. Any question on extreme programming? Anyone? Okay, so next framework we would talk about DevOps framework. Now, what is DevOps at the first place? So it is again an sub framework within your Agile framework. So it's a culture which promotes collaboration between the developer, development and operation teams to deploy code to production faster in an automated and repeatable way. So anyone heard about a tool called as Octopus? Hello.
No.
Familiar with any DevOps tool? Anything, Jenkins for that matter, or any proprietary tools your company might be using? Okay. So what happens in DevOps model is like, your developer and QA people, they are directly interacting with the IT operation people. IT operations as in the people who are responsible for operation. Operation as in whenever you are calling a particular customer service representative, if you have purchased an insurance policy, you are calling a customer service representative. So that representative is part of your operations team. So he has all the necessary inputs pertaining to your insurance policy, like what date you purchased it, what is the expiration date, excuse me, what is the premium amount that you are paying every year, what are the typical coverages that you have taken for your auto insurance. All those details would be there with that operations representative. Now, one aspect is that you are building a project from scratch and you are gathering requirements, which requires a business analyst involvement or to a larger scale. But what happens after your project is completed from the development side, and it is actually into operations team? And for that matter, let's say the maintenance part is also over, whatever minimal changes that were needed, additional changes that were needed, that has also been completed. Now, whatever you are requesting, the changes or the improvement in the system, those are something that are arising out of the day-to-day operations. So those changes are something which are very minimal in nature. Minimal as in from an effort perspective. It may not take more than 1 hour to develop or do that necessary change. It could be a data fix as well. Data fix as in you need to change a particular coverage. It is not possible from front end. So what you would do, you would ask your developer or the tester, the support team, and you would say, go and change it in the backend. So those kind of changes are taken care in the DevOps model. So that's the reason why developers and testers collaborate directly with the operation team, who are the front-facing people to the end customers. So there is no involvement of any other people within this particular team. And since the code is already developed, the project is already complete, the maintenance is almost done, so it's not that difficult to deploy this code on a daily basis or within 2-3 hours as well. So that way DevOps helps the team or helps the development environment to develop a particular request or a particular change request or release request within a couple of hours. So that's the reason why DevOps came into the picture. And most of the things over here are automated and are repetitive in nature. Automated as in, if you are just doing a simple data change within a SQL by using a SQL script, so there is no more not a much impact that would happen into the particular system. You would only compile the script file of that SQL and you would deploy that particular code, so it shouldn't take more than 2 hours of effort. That's the reason DevOps is that much fast in terms of implementation, because the nature of work is very small. It's not something that you have to span across months like in case of Scrum. So here are certain DevOps principles, like it's customer centric action. DevOps team must take customer centric action for that. They should constantly invest in products and services. End-to-end responsibility has to be taken up by the development team. Continuous improvement has to be there. Automation has to be there from one environment to another environment, because whenever, even though it's a data fix, you would be changing as a developer in your local environment. Now pushing that code from local to SIT, then SIT to UAT and UAT to production, that has to be an automated process, because no much effort is needed in terms of testing that particular small data fix. So that's why we could go with the option of automating everything, and we have to work as one team, monitor and test everything. So these are some of the significance of DevOps: predictability, reproducibility, maintainability, time to market, quality, reduce risk, resiliency, cost efficiency, and breaks larger code base into small pieces. Now, when to use DevOps and when not to use DevOps? So it should be used for large distributed applications such as e-commerce site or application hosted on a cloud platform. This is where you use DevOps team, because essentially the amount of data that we receive from e-commerce site is huge, and there is huge possibility that you would be needing data fixes there or script file changes over there. So that's the reason why we need large scale distributed application in order to use DevOps. And when not to use DevOps? It should not be used in a mission critical application like bank, power, and other sensitive data sets. Such application need strict access control to the prod environment, a detailed change management policy, access control policy to the data center. So essentially, projects which are typically falls under BFSI domain, that is banking, financial services, and insurance domain, do not use DevOps model. But the retail supply chain domain or healthcare domain, wherein the data is massive, in those projects you can use DevOps. But again, it's a part of perception. These days banking projects are also using DevOps model, and insurance projects are also using DevOps model. My current project is using DevOps model, which is in insurance. So this is the life cycle of DevOps. The development team, development things happens, then testing happens, integration, deployment, and monitoring. So once you do the deployment, you have to monitor for a period of 7 days or 15 days as per the contract, so that if any warranty support is needed, you could provide it. Now, since the nature of development is very limited in this particular framework, so the codes are deployed in every 2 hours or 4 hours, maybe within 24 hours, and that too it is automated. So automated as in, there is a batch job schedule which would execute it every 6 hours and would check what all code are ready to be deployed to the production environment. And developer need not be asked to manually push their code to the prod environment. The batch job would take care of. That is how you are automating. Okay, so this is the development DevOps lifecycle. You could go through it as per your convenience. Now we would summarize what we have learned so far in session 2 and session 3. So in session 2, we have completed primitive methodology. There we had a customer, the software requirement. In between there was developer and tester, and then we have your operation and IT infrastructure. This is the hierarchy which we followed, and this was how we were interacting with each other in a bi-directional manner. What happened in Agile is we addressed the gap between customer and the developer and tester. Okay, here we have addressed the gap, but this gap is not addressed between the developer, tester and the operation and IT infrastructure. Whatever the queries is to happen, is to raise by the operation and infrastructure, it has to go through the customer, then the business analyst, then the team, and then go to the developer and tester. So what happened essentially in DevOps is directly the interaction happened, the developer and tester started directly interacting with the operation and IT infrastructure. More emphasis were given in their relationship. So that is how things have changed. So to summarize, we covered these three advanced framework in today's session.
So what's the role of BA in DevOps?
So BA do not have any major role to play, to be very honest, in DevOps infrastructure. So like my project is doing DevOps only for deployment perspective. They are automating the code from one environment to another environment. So we don't that much interact with the DevOps team, but we do direct interaction with the development team. So you could say that you support the developers in and around their particular queries which they get from the operations team. So if operation teams ask the developer to do this this particular fix, it would ultimately come as a ticket in a particular ticket management system like Jira. So that ticket has to be first validated by a business analyst before the developer starts working on it. So that is where the BA plays a role.